the throne of grace and to begin our celebration in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
Good evening to you all.
Amen.
And I welcome you to today's Mass, when the Lord reassures us of his presence among us. He reminds us today, he says, even before we were formed in the womb, he knew us through and through. That goes to buttress what the word of God said, that children are a blessing from the Lord. God reminds you today, as he reminds me, that he has set us up as a standard to destroy whatever that is evil and unjust, to go into the world and be the principles of goodness. He says to us, not to be afraid of the attacks that will come, not to be afraid of the intentions and thoughts of people. You know why? He is always with us, and we shall never be crushed. If the Lord is for us, who can be against us? Let us walk every day renewed in that same strength, my brothers and sisters, that we are God's children, and as his children, he is the good shepherd. The good shepherd does nothing but to guide, to feed, and to be there for the flock. He will always be there for each and every one of us, for he does not let us down. We pray every day that the Lord may continue to show us his face, and we might continue to reflect the image of the Christ crucified through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
At this Mass, we are requested to pray for
the repose of the soul of Brad Bishop.
My brothers and sisters, we are sinners in need of God's grace. Let us therefore take a moment to recall the many times we have failed God and man, to be sorry for those times, and humbly ask God for his pardon and peace.
Lord Jesus, you are the everlasting Son of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you are the Word made flesh and Savior of the world. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you lead us to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And may the Almighty God have mercy on us. May he forgive us our sins and bring us to life everlasting.
We praise.
our God, that we may honor you with all our mind and love everyone in truth of heart, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A proclamation from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I dedicated you. A prophet of nations, I appointed you. But do you gird your loins, stand up, and tell them all that I command you? Be not crushed on their account, as though I would leave you crushed before them. For it is I this day who have made you a fortified city, a pillar of iron, a wall of brass, against the whole land, against Judah's kings and priests, against its priests and people. They will fight against you, but not prevail over you. For I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, strive eagerly for the greatest spiritual gifts, but I shall show you a still more excellent way. If I speak in human and angelic tongues, but I do not have love, I am a resounding gong or a clashing cymbal. And if I have the gift of prophecy and comprehend all mysteries and knowledge, if I have all faith so as to move mountains, but I do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away everything I own, and if I hand my body over so I may boast, but I do not have love, I gain nothing. love is patient, love is kind. It is not jealous, it is not pompous. It is not inflated, it is not rude. It does not seek its own interest. It is not quick-tempered, it does not brood over injury. It does not rejoice over wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. If there are prophecies, they will be brought to nothing. If tongues, they will cease. If knowledge, it will be brought to nothing. For we know partially and we prophesy partially. But when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I used to talk as a child, think as a child, reason as a child. When I became a man, I put aside childish things. At present, we see indistinctly, as in a mirror, but then face to face. At present, I know partially, then I shall know fully, as I am fully known. So faith, hope, love remain, these three. But the greatest of these is love. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Did anybody go through this gospel before now? Just one? Two? Three? Okay. Margaret, four. So in the whole church, just four persons went through the readings and prepared themselves for Mass. That is wrong.
is wrong. We have, I probably am wrong, and I think I'm wrong. Because I thought we have overgrown this attitude, right? Because when I came in here, that was the first, that was our foundation. That every day before every mass, before you go to bed, you take the reading of the following day. And I thought, you know, we have grown, and we are growing in the scriptures and in our spiritual life. Probably we are still where we are, right? Probably we are still where we began from, right? Thank you. At least I got the yes. My brothers and sisters, why I'm asking this is this. You know, sometimes in life, if the practical things of life do not happen to you, you will not understand exactly what sometimes the scripture talks about. When you get to Luke chapter number 4, beginning from verse number 21, the Gospel of Luke chapter number 4. But then before verse 21, you will see when Jesus got into the synagogue, that is the continuation of this we read this evening. The word of God said, he came and he sat, and all eyes were fixed on him. And the assistant gave him the scroll of the prophet Isaiah, and he opened it up. It was Isaiah chapter number 61, and he read, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Then he went on to enumerate the functions of the Spirit of the Lord on each and every one of us. To set the captives free, to liberate everyone, to be charitable, to give bread and food to the hungry, to see to the needs of one another, to make sure that everyone is fine under God's protection. That was the first part. Then where we read today, the continuation of that, when Jesus finished, he said, this passage, this gospel prophecy, this prophecy of the prophet, the prophecy of the prophet Isaiah is being fulfilled in your midst. But look at the human being. The first part of the gospel, he says, he sat there. Get the missiles on your seats. They are the gospel of today. Luke chapter number 4. If you open your Bible, Luke chapter number 4. Begin from verse number 21. I want us to see the human act, the act of man. Luke chapter number 4. Beginning from verse number 21. Chapter 4. 421. Where is chapter 4? Okay, it's here. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
He says, he then rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the assistant, and then he sat down. And all eyes of the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to speak to them. This text is being fulfilled today, even while you are listening. And he won the approval of all. And I want us to follow this gradually. He says, he won the approval of all. And they were astonished by the gracious words that came from his mouth. He was talking to them. They were astonished. Their hearts began to burn with the zeal to do what is right, the zeal for God. And he won the approval of all. Those same crowd, those same people turned around. At that instant, even as he was speaking, they were praising him. But they were nursing the wrong things in their hearts. Sometimes it is like that with us. That we praise people, but then within our hearts, we are thinking a different thing. We tell people we are praying for you, but actually in our hearts, we are not. We tend to pretend and do what is right before them, but then behind them, we are a different thing. This same crowd, whose admiration the Lord won, and the other way around, turned again. Is this, just read the next verse down there. Is this not the son of the carpenter? Just a few minutes of praise. At the same minute, it's just like within the 60 seconds of a minute, 30 is for praise, 30 is for condemnation. They began to talk about him. Is this not the son of the carpenter? Who does he think he is? Why is everybody praising him? Now the question becomes, why did they even come to listen to him? Sometimes we go to have discussions with people, we already blocked. Am I right? Sometimes we fail to go and have discussions with people because we have blocked our minds. Sometimes we are only going there to seek out faults, not to listen and be enriched. Because we are empty and we think we are full. And that was what happened to the scribes and the Pharisees. They came before the Lord. They saw the hair, the wisdom coming from him. They couldn't take it. So, in order to push everybody away, they began asking the question. Jay, no, I know your husband. Is that not the handkerchief man? What does he have? He has nothing. When people want to divide you, this is what they do. Each and every one of us, I'm not talking about you, I'm talking about a human person. When the truth is there, Bill, sometimes we do not want to accept the truth. What we do is to do what? Destroy the other. Present what is not true. We cause problems everywhere we are found. The scribes and the hypocrites did the same. Is this not the son of the carpenter? They wanted to run him down so that he cannot grow. But let me tell you, whatever need the Lord has instituted, there is nothing anyone can do about it. The word of God says, if the Lord is with us and for us, who can be against us? Listen, no one. But then we have to work hard, stand by the standard of God, that we do not derail, that we do what is right and stick to it. The grace of God will always stick to us, stand by us, be in us, and see us through. Jesus was not afraid. He looked at them in their faces because he knew what was in their hearts. He knew the evil they were propagating. And he said to them, I know what is in your hearts. You will quote for me the Proverbs. Physician, heal yourself. What you did in other places, do it here and let us see. Doubt. When doubt sets in your life, you have begun to do what? To mark an end to the progress of spirituality in you. When doubt sets in, you have decided to do what? To stunt your growth. And that was what happened. They wanted signs and wonders. Meanwhile, something greater than the sign was there in their midst. They refused to acknowledge it. And what did they do? They began plotting against him. Sometimes in our lives, we fail to tell our friends, to tell people the truth. What brings about joy? What brings peace? Who has a Bible? Open the Bible. Proverbs chapter number 10. Let somebody read Proverbs. Proverbs chapter number 10. Proverbs. The Bibles are on your seats. I don't want to see anybody looking at me. I want to see you looking at the Bible, not me. Get that one. Give her one. Proverbs chapter number 10. Who has it?
What verse?
Go back to verse number 10.
Chapter 10:10.
Yes.
A wink of the eye brings trouble.
But it's not finished.
A bold rebuke brings peace.
A wink of the eye brings trouble, but a bold rebuke brings peace. Did you get that? Did you get that? You know, wink to your friend. Yeah, that's fine. It is not fine. It is not okay. Rebuke the person. Jesus looked at them. He saw the evil in their heart and he rebuked them. Bold rebuke. When someone loves you, he rebukes you when you have done what is wrong, so that you do not perpetuate evil. You do not continue to live in sin. You do not continue to live in hurt. So that wrongdoing stops. That's what Jesus is telling us today. He wasn't afraid of what was coming forth. He knew what they would do. He knew what their reaction was going to be. But that did not deter him from telling them the truth to their face. You will vote for me. But I tell you in all honesty, whether you like it or not, this gospel passage of liberation, of liberating captives, of seeing that everyone is enjoying the grace of God, is being fulfilled before you. And before them, it got fulfilled. Because you know why? He healed the sick. He comforted the afflicted. He restored everyone to that initial state of joy. But those who were wicked failed to see it. They failed to accept it. They failed to assimilate it. What did they do? They went and yanked him out. But you see, when we fear the reactions of people, we cannot progress. Because you know why? You will constantly find yourself or be thinking about what other people will do, about their reactions that you stand. You are neither gold nor heart. But God has commissioned you for something, something great. Jeremiah chapter number 1, where we read today, the word of God said, look, I have put my words in you, and I am sending you out for a purpose. I want you to go and achieve. Go and speak my words to my people. They will fight you. But be strong. Never worry about it. You know why? In my name, they will never crush you. Sometimes we are afraid of the reactions of what people will say. My brothers and sisters, God has commissioned us to go and kill. To go and destroy. Not to kill. Not to kill human being. I want to explain that now. Not to kill the human person. But to go and kill whatever that is evil everywhere. To stand for the truth. That we may uproot. But it says in his name, we shall bring it back. Jeremiah prophesied. God has commissioned us. He has commissioned you. Do you know what he has commissioned you to do? Are you standing for the truth? Are you afraid of reactions? They will call me names. They will ostracize me. The same happened to the prophets of old. And none was afraid. None suffered it. Because they did what? They put their trust in God, in whom is eternal life. How often do we tell our brothers and sisters the truth? How often do we talk to one another? Does the truth live in you? Do not stop it. The word of God said, I know why there is a problem in me. Because I kept the word of God to myself and my frame was wasted. God doesn't want anybody's frame to waste. He wants us to love one another. A bold rebuke seals for peace. It is one who loves you that will rebuke you. That was why St. Paul today, in writing to the Corinthians in chapter number 13, he reminds us in verse number 13, he says, there are only three things that last. Faith, hope, and love. But he said among them, one is the greatest. And that is what? That is love. But then he went on to tell us what love is and what love is not. Who has it? Open up wherever we're at. First Corinthians chapter number 13. Oh, just open up the missals. It's in the missal. It is in the missal. Yes. What we read, the gospel.
What verse,
Father Chris? First Corinthians chapter number 13. When you get down to verse number 13, who has it? It is both everywhere in the Bible as it is in the missal.
So faith, hope, love remain.
Faith.
Three.
Faith, hope, and love remains. Great.
But the greatest of these is love.
But the greatest of these is love. But then when you go above that, what does it say? Go down and begin from 9. Verse number 9. It tells us what love is and what love is not. That love does not gloat over evil. Let me just go down to it. Go ahead. Yes, read.
Love is patient.
Love is patient.
Love is kind.
Love is kind.
It is not jealous.
It is not jealous.
Not pompous.
Love is not pompous.
It is not inflated.
It is not inflated.
It is not rude.
Love is not rude.
It does not seek its own interest.
Hold it there. Hold it there. Love does not seek anything for its own interest. But sometimes in the world of today, what do we see? I love you. First of all, check. What do you have that he or she wants? Am I right? You know, guys, I don't know about America, you know, but in Nigeria, there's a common saying. When a lady tells you, I love you, probably she has seen your check by your bank account, and it is rich. Or maybe you have just bought a new car, or you built a house, or you rented a big house, and it's good. And she says, I love you. Hey, wait now. There is something surrounding you she has said that she wants. So also, some of us this time around, that we have thrown away love. It doesn't make any meaning to us. That we fail to say the truth to the other because we don't, it doesn't hold. There is something we are looking out to gain and out there. Nothing to gain. He sacrificed himself, and this is love. He does not seek anything for his own. God did not die on the cross to go to heaven. Am I right? Christ did not die, he did not die on the cross that he may go to heaven. He died on the cross that we may go to heaven. That is emptying himself. Philippians chapter number 3 reminds us of the same thing. Are you challenged? Are you living by love, abiding by the word of God? God has set you up as a standard that you may love others, that you may seek their good, and do what is in accordance with the commandments of God. That is love. Love does not count any cost. It does not count anything of its own. Christ went about doing good, showing us what love meant. Even when he was attacked, he still stood, knowing that the prophecy of Isaiah will come, the Jeremiah will come to pass. In your life, it will come to pass. All you need to do is to hold on and be strong. Look at evil in the face and say, this is evil. Look at wrongdoing in the face and say, this is wrongdoing, and I will not stand by it. Material gains, as it were, never profits us for eternal life. It doesn't. No. What profits us for eternal life is our hope in the resurrection that Christ has given us. It's our faith in the only begotten Son of God. Our faith in the three persons in one God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And proclaiming it, the word of God said, by proclaiming that we are saved. Do you proclaim that? Does love propel your actions and motivate all your actions? Or are your actions hinged on something? When they are hinged on something, they bear you no fruit. They bear the other no fruit. It is worthless. When you do good, what is the intention for that goodness? When we go out of our way to help others, what is the reason behind, the motivation behind that? Is it the selfless love of Christ or the love of the human person to be praised by men, and it ends there? Today God telling Jesus, my brothers and sisters, to be sure that he has. I think Isaiah 59. Let me see what Isaiah 59 says. Just come into my head. Let me see. Let somebody open Isaiah chapter number 59, the prophet Isaiah. 5:9, not 6. 5:9. I can't even find where it is. Amen.
What verse?
There's something I am looking for more than I'm coming. Isaiah chapter number 59. Verse number 21, can somebody read?
21, for my part?
Yes.
This is my covenant with them.
For my part, and I want us to remember this. God is reminding us. He says, for my part and for your part, go on. My covenant with them is this.
Says the Lord, my spirit with which I endowed you.
God is reminding you sitting here that he has endowed each and every one of us with his spirit. And I want you to remember this. So when you are faced with difficulties and trials, when you are faced with challenges, remember this, that the Lord has endowed you. It did not say the Lord has just given. Amen? I want us to understand the words of the scripture. It says the Lord has endowed you. Abundantly is what that means. The Lord has lavished upon you. He has filled you. Isaiah 59, verse number 21. Yes, go on.
And my words that I have put in your mouth.
He has put his words in our mouth.
Will not leave your mouth or the mouths of your children.
And he says it will never leave your mouth or the mouth of your children, or the mouth of your children's children, that from generation to generation, it will never pass away. It will continue to move. But then what is that mouth? What is that word? What is that commandment? What is that light of Christ? Love, hope, and faith. St. Paul puts it well. We may hear a gong ringing and ringing and informing everybody. If we are not ringing in love, it is a waste. You might be the greatest helper in the world, helping everybody, even the dead. If you do not do it with passion, with love and with respect, it is dead. It has nothing to offer. If you make friends of all the whole world, you want everybody to come to you. If you have no love motivating you to affect their lives positively, it is dead. What motivates your actions? God has given us his spiritual blessings. 1 Corinthians chapter number 12. The word of God gave us the gift of the Spirit. God has given us the fullness of the gift of his Spirit. And it says, if you speak in tongues and you do not do that in love, you pass no message. Do you understand? That I am but a priest and I preach the word of God. If I do not preach it with love, I am an idiot. Amen? Yes. That's what the word of God says. It is a waste. So why don't we as God's children look at our lives, see where love is, see what motivates us, see how we can positively affect the life of others, and the Lord may take glory in us. Today he's telling Jesus, are you happy with your life? He has endowed you with his word, with his Spirit. What are you doing with it? He is asking you today, Roger, what are you doing with that free gift of God? John, never lose sight of it, for he is there. The fullness of his Spirit is with each and every one of us. Today he reminds us to go on in joy, to go on in hope, to ask ourselves, where is my faith? Where is my hope? Where is my love? If I have these three, thanks be to God. But then, do I accomplish the two with the love of Christ? The love that makes us stand firm in the face of negativity. The devil comes from every angle, my brothers and sisters, to destroy us, to see that we do not maintain that relationship with God. Christ is asking you today, let your faith in him destroy those challenges. The word of God says to us, have you been able to find out what God wants for you? Let us work hard every day, that the grace of God in us may bear fruit. Let us work hard. Remember it. He promised us, Jeremiah chapter number 1, he said he will never leave us alone. He has sent us out, not as orphans, but he is there with us and always. Be strong when things happen to you. Be strong when things come your way. You know why? There is always joy at the end of every struggle. Keep on struggling, but that joy is greater than what is happening at the moment. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Arise and in faith, bring our needs to our loving Father, that he may hear us and grant our needs. As first we profess our faith, I believe in one God.
Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, Son is holy and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
We take time now to call to mind our needs and the needs of the human family. As members of Christ's body, we can be confident that with our prayers will be heard. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the church, that we may accept voices of truth inspired by the Spirit, even if they challenge or criticize, and so bring the body of Christ to greater unity and holiness. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For world leaders, that they may respond with love to the difficulties of their citizens and neighbors. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an end to human trafficking or exploitation for those who are most vulnerable, women, teens, and children, and those living in poverty. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who suffer from chronic illness, for the families of those who care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
All the prayers we hold in the silence of heart, all our intentions spoken and unspoken, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God our Father, in your mercy, come to our aid. Help us to stand firm on the principles of love, faith, and hope. And may our hope bear us fruit for eternal life. Come to our weaknesses, O Lord, and strengthen us. Revive us and restore our joy. Grant us good health of mind and body. And in your mercy, grant more than we ask you for, spoken and unspoken, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our offertory window number 669, Beautiful Savior, number 669.
Son of God, send us.
sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands. May praise the Lord at your name. For our good and all of the church.
Amen. O Lord, we bring to your altar these offerings of our service. Be pleased to receive them, we pray, and transform them into the sacrament of our redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
Lift up your hands.
Amen.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you laid the foundations of the world and have arranged the changes of times and seasons. You formed man in your own image and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder, to rule in your name over all you have made, and forever praise you in your mighty works through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And so with all the angels we praise you, as a joyful celebration we acclaim. Sending down your spirit upon them like a newborn, so that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving you thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Daniel, our Archbishop, Charles' auxiliary, and all the clergy, remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, our spouse, with the blessed apostles and saints, St. Paul, St. Francis de Sales, St. Apostle, St. Ignatius, St. Anthony, St. Dominic, St. Lawrence, St. Timothy, St. Augustine, St. Augustus, St. Elizabeth, St. Veronica, St. Cecilia, St. Anne Bopre, St. Justine Paquita, St. Patricia, St. Anna, St. Monica, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace and joy and healing of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you always.
And with your spirit. Now let us share a sign of peace with each other.
Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. He takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those of us called to this supper of the Lamb.
Lord,
the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring us to eternal life.
Amen.
By these redeeming gifts, we pray, O Lord, that through this help to eternal salvation, through faith, may ever increase, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for the announcement.
The Junior Catholic Order will have a Valentine bake sale next week here, February the 9th and 10th, after all masses. Confirmation Mass is this Friday, February the 8th at 7 p.m. Presiding Bishop is Bishop Schultz. Please see the bulletin for the Ash Wednesday Mass schedule.
Good evening to you all.
Good evening.
Two announcements. I will say the prayer for the blessing of the troops, okay? We are to do it today. I will say the prayers and the blessings. And we will be here, pray for us, one, two, three. But I know, just go from anywhere. You know what I mean? So that wherever you see there's no much line, just get it so that you can live in good time. That is one. Just to let you know, next week, I'll be away. We are having the retreat next week. So, for those of us who are the third batch, we'll be leaving on Monday. I'll be here for Monday Mass. And then probably sometime in the afternoon or in the evening, I'll be driving down to Boca Hill, the Holy M Passionist Retreat Center. So you pray for us while we pray for you. We'll be there for 1-5 days. Of 4 days, beginning from Monday, ending Friday morning. But I might be here just the evening of Friday morning because we have confirmations here on Friday. Am I right? So please, just try to come around. And I've written to the bishop asking if you could help us within this period to bless our statue and our prayer area. So it's going to be a great day for us. Friday next week, I think it's by 6 or 5. What's the time for the confirmation? 7. Okay. Oh, that's good. So many of you would have gone and come back and probably eaten. So just come in and let us sleep in the Lord. Amen? That is it. So just try Friday. And then remember to pray for us and to pray for the church going through crisis at this moment. But we shall overcome. Am I right?
Yes.
Because we have always. It is the church of God. Jeremiah said today, they will never win us because we'll be sent by God. And he said he will stick and will be by us. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. I got a letter from the chancellor asking if I could join. Okay, they said, Joseph. So I've been chosen to go to Indiana sometime in June. But I'll enlighten you on that later. To represent the Archdiocese in what is happening at Notre Dame. So Lord, there are 4 of us who will go, the priest of the Archdiocese. So pray for us too, and continue to pray for God to guide us. Amen.
Amen.
Then we please stand. The Lord be with you.
Amen.
Through the intercession of St. Blaise, Bishop and Martyr, may God deliver you from every disease of the throat and from every other diseases and illnesses. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We will go in the peace and love of Christ, for this Mass is ended.
Thank you, God.
God bless you, and you have a wonderful week.
God bless you, Father. Thank you.
Our closing hymn is number 700. Now thank we all our God.